Team and kids, you can go to your respective corners and head on out to Children's Ministry, and we can give thanks for the kids as they make that journey, and let's pray for them as they go. Heavenly Father, I thank you that Jesus said, let the children come to me, and reminded us that children are never a distraction, that we want to help make sure that they get to learn about Jesus and know him and love him. And we are grateful for each one of the leaders and the staff members that are going to be helping them hear the story of the goodness of God. And we are grateful for them. God, now I pray that you would help everyone hear exactly what it is that you need them to hear, regardless of the words that come out of my mouth, and help me get out of the way so you can come and truly be the way, the truth, and the life in the lives of those who are gathered here. In Jesus' name, we love you and we thank you. Amen. So today we're going to finish our sermon series on why God, the big questions that we ask, the huge questions. And the great news is that we have a God who allows us to ask him difficult questions. Of course, the more important question, though, is how. Like, how do we deal with the suffering and pain that Jesus promises us is going to come our way in life? But we've asked, God, how could you let this happen to me or someone I love? We've asked, why do my prayers go unanswered? Last week, we asked, why can't I see God's will for my life? And we established that one of the things was important, that the Bible had a lot of things to say about God's general will. And if we could get a lot of clarity about that, about moving forward with God's general will operating in our lives, the specific will stuff oftentimes will take care of itself. And asking why of God is an important thing to do. Because it keeps us in the relationship, and we stay in the relationship when, not if, we struggle with something. We're going to struggle sometimes. Asking why presupposes that we are seeking and desiring a deeper connection with the living God. And that's good news. Now today, we've got a little curveball. We're going to do a little different kind of a question, because today's question is, why does God's love prevail? And that's a really important question. One of the things that I like to ask people on a regular basis is, are you aware of how much God loves you today? And I always love getting to hear what people's responses are, because sometimes people are immediately confident. They say, yes, I am. I'm aware of how much God loves me. Sometimes they kind of go, I think so. I said, well, we need to clarify that. Hopefully by the end of the message today, you will have a lot more confidence about God's love for you. One time someone actually said to me, I wish it could be true. I wish it could be true. And it's like that led to a good conversation about the reality of God's unconditional love and God's desire for that person to receive it fully and completely into their lives. And that's a hard thing to do sometimes, but God's love does prevail. And I've had many, many teachers along the way in my life who have helped me see the reality that God's love prevails. But one of my best teachers was my buddy from over 40 years ago. His name was Richard. And here's a picture of Richard and I at the camp that we worked at. Yeah, we were goofballs. So in this picture, we're just having some fun. But Richard had graduated from high school that year, and he played high school football. He was an offensive lineman, and he weighed about 250 pounds, which was considered big back in 1980. That's a long time ago, folks. An offensive lineman at 250 is not very big anymore, but he was strong as an ox, and he was fast. And all the guys at camp would play a game on Saturdays when there were no campers around, and we called the game, Can Richard Throw Everyone Off the Dock? And the reality is Richard always won. He always got every one of us tossed off. We could never got him. Now, over the summer, Richard lost a lot of weight. It was hot. He was active. And he had no intention of playing football any longer. So, I mean, he was looking really great. That picture was from the end of the summer. And he had gotten down to about 215. He was 6'2", looking good. But he had discovered that he had this nagging backache. And I remember we teased him mercilessly when he went to the pharmacy and he got Doane's pills for his back pain, because that's advertised for old people. And here's Richard at 18, 19 years old getting these Doane's pills. But a few weeks after camp, Richard went to the doctor for his back pain, and he was diagnosed with leukemia. which that diagnosis for such a young man, such a good friend really sent me all kinds of different places about why God. When I heard the news, I was back at seminary in Atlanta, and so I decided a few weeks later I needed to drive down and see Richard at Tampa. He was in Tampa General Hospital. And on the 8-hour drive from Atlanta to Tampa, I rehearsed all the brilliant theology that I was learning, that I was going to share with Richard about you know, the suffering and what he's going through. And so we sat down and we talked, and I told him all of my stuff. I'd rehearsed all my lines. And I'll never forget what Richard said to me. "Jamie, I am really glad you're here. I am so grateful for your friendship. But you know what? I'm not asking any of those questions. I'm not asking, why me, God? I've already said, why not me, God? What would make me think that I am so special that I could be free of disease? And you know what, Jamie? No matter what, live or die, I am abundantly clear that God loves me." Richard knew that no matter what, God's love would prevail in his life. Reminded me of C.S. Lewis's words when he said, you will never know how much you believe something until it's life or death. And the fact is, it was life or death for Richard. And Richard's funeral was wonderful and awful all at the same time. His life, his death, his eternal life affirmed 4 key things about God's love prevailing for me. And they're very important. Number one, God walks with us through everything that we experience. Isaiah 41, verse 10 declares it very clearly. He says, "Don't be afraid, for I am with you. Don't be discouraged, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will hold you up by my victorious right hand." Sometimes that's all we have to hang on to, is the fact that God is in fact with us. Sometimes people face such terrible circumstances, so much difficult suffering, that they make a choice to give up on God, especially if he doesn't seem to be doing what is in line with what they want done. It's not going the way they thought it would go. The reality is, that's always hard. But Richard showed me an approach. He took an approach that God didn't give him leukemia. That is, God didn't say, "Hey, let me test Richard with this horrible disease. I'm going to give him leukemia and see if he will still love and serve me." But guess what? Even if God did do that, Richard would have chosen to walk with him through the fire. As John Wesley was getting ready to die, the founder of the Methodist movement, he was 87 years. He'd lived a really long, really well-served life. He preached all over England, all over lots of places. He spent 250,000 miles riding on the back of a horse to get around the country. And so now he's at the end, and there's all these people that are gathered around his bed. And what they're doing is they're leaning in to hear what his last words are going to be. There's always some incredible last words that people can speak. And so the pressure was on. I mean, the founder of this Methodist movement, what's he going to say? What's his last words going to be? And John Wesley's last words were, "Best of all, God is with us." And the truth is, even when we want more than that, sometimes God being with us has to be enough. We finished up 2 Corinthians yesterday with our daily devotional, our SOAP. And on Friday, we read 2 Corinthians 12, where Paul talks about having a thorn in the flesh. Now, we don't know what the thorn in the flesh was that he had. It could have been some problem with his vision. It could have been some arthritis, because sometimes in his letters he'll say, "I write this with my very own hand," assuming that would be very, very painful, whatever it was, or he couldn't see. Now, we don't know. I'm glad we don't know what his specific thorn in the flesh was, because if we did, we'd align it more with what, okay, this is about that thing. But no, this is a thing. This is a generalized truth that's important for us. And in 2 Corinthians 12:8, Paul said, 3 different times, "I begged the Lord to take it away." Now, I think it's safe that we can assume that this wasn't some throwaway casual prayer time where he said, "God, heal me, heal me, heal me." I think this was, he was bending his knees. He was praying with great intensity. And then in verse 9a, it says, each time he said, my grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. I like the way the English Standard Version says it a little bit better. It says, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. In other words, what Paul was declaring, that no matter what, whether God healed him or not, he was saying, God's love prevails. Even though my prayer is not going to be answered in the way that I hope or expect, this is true. I'm trusting in that reality. And God chose not to give Paul physical healing, but instead he gave Paul a spiritual insight that I think helps us 2,000 years later lean into the prevailing love of God for us. Second thing that Richard taught me is that God works through us in the midst of our suffering, in the midst of our difficulty. My visit with Richard, that I'd come 8 hours to see him, really meant so much to him. And he was really clear about that. My words, not so much. He didn't really care about those. God worked, though, in me showing up and being present, not by giving some great theological words of wisdom to Richard, but just through my presence. You remember in Job chapter 2, where Job, his friends saw him suffering, and they came from far distances, and they sat with him, and they just were quiet and still with him for 7 solid days as they just listened to him cry out in pain. And then when they began to talk and explain his suffering, they ruined it. They opened their mouth and messed it up. And so the reality is sometimes being present is the most important thing that we can do for people, because that's one of the key ways that God works through us. And God worked through Richard in innumerable ways in my life, in life, death, and in his eternal life. One afternoon, Richard at camp, he taught me how to sail. I thought that would be a pretty good idea, since the very next day I was going to be leading a sailing class. And I'd never sat in a sailing boat before. So I think I kind of needed to learn that. The one lesson that I remember from what he taught me was to tack. There was a big storm coming up over the central Florida like crazy. And we're in Leesburg and in Lake Griffin, and the storm came up out of nowhere. It was calm and nice. And it's like, I said, here, take the reins of the boat here. Get us where we need to go, because we'd gone all the way across the lake. And he looked at me and said, you got us over here. You're getting us back. I said, okay. So I tacked. And we finally got to shore on the other side in the midst of a big, big storm. What I always remember, I've got this great quote, and I always think of him when I read it. Pessimists complain about the wind. Optimists expect that the wind will always change. Leaders make a decision to catch whatever wind is available. I always think of Richard when I read that. The truth is that we find this reality that God works through us on almost every page of the Bible. And we need that message. C.S. Lewis says that God whispers in our pleasures, speaks through our conscience, and shouts in our pain. And that's true, isn't it? But I don't know about you, but my preference would be a whole lot more whispering, please, God, and a whole lot less shouting in my pain. But as we care and as we listen to others in their suffering, we get to be God with skin on for each other. If you're interested in any advice, here's a piece. Don't try to talk someone out of their pain or anger at God. How would you respond to someone trying to talk you out of your pain or anger at God? And they said, you shouldn't feel this way. When someone says that to me, it's like, I think you're trying to take something away from me, or you're trying to deny the truth of what I'm experiencing and the pain I'm feeling, or the anger that it's not legitimate somehow. And that's not really very helpful. The important principle of God working through us, okay, is that we human beings care for one another, and God is responsible for curing us in whatever way God sees fit. Richard, he also taught me, third thing he taught me was that in the midst of suffering and death. God bends suffering and even evil in our lives toward his will. The song that we sang, the Another in the Fire, that's from Daniel chapter 3, where Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are confronted by Nebuchadnezzar. That's four mouthfuls of names right there, isn't it? Where Nebuchadnezzar said, hey, I need you guys to kneel down before the 90-foot idol that I built for myself, and I need you to worship it. I need you to worship me. And their comment was, well, and he said, if you don't, I'm going to throw you in a furnace, fiery furnace. And they said, well, Nebuchadnezzar, with all due respect, our God can save us through that fire. And even if he does not, we will not bend the knee to your statue. We will not bend the knee to you. We worship the living God alone. In the midst of suffering and evil, God bends that in our lives toward his best will for our lives. Now, just because God brings good out of evil doesn't mean that the suffering itself is good. We can't get confused about that. I think Paul states that pretty clearly in Romans chapter 8, 28, where he says, and we know, not we guess, we think, we surmise, but we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. So when we're clear that we love God and that we have a clear calling from God and it's related to his purpose for us, then not that everything that happens to us is good, but that God causes everything eventually to work together for our good. That's different. So Paul's not saying everything is good, but he's saying that God has the ability to use every experience that we go through, the good and the bad and the ugly of life, for his glory and for our benefit in the long term. And when we need assurance from God that his love prevails in our lives and that God has the ability to bend suffering and evil in our lives to his will, a great place to turn is just a few verses ahead in Romans chapter 8, beginning at verse 31. It says, if God is for us, who can ever be against us? Since he did not spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, won't he also give us everything else? Who dares accuse us whom God has chosen for his own? No one, for God himself has given us right standing with himself. Who then will condemn us? No one, for Christ Jesus died for us and was raised to life for us. And he is sitting in the place of honor at God's right hand, pleading for us. Isn't that great? Think about that. What is Jesus busy doing as we are facing suffering and evil? He's crying out to the Father. He's crying out on our behalf for God's best in our lives. Verse 35, can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death? No. Despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loves us. And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, angels nor demons, our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from the love of God. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Bam! He said, take that to the bank. Soren Kierkegaard, a famous Christian philosopher from the 1800s, he said, life is lived forward and understood backwards, meaning that as we look back over our life, then we can see some of that God's purpose, God working out his will in our lives carefully and what we're causing that things to work together for good. But we can't see that in the midst of living it forward sometimes. We don't always get to see how God is at work as we suffer, as we go through things. Think about the primary symbol of the Protestant faith is an empty cross. And that's for us, that means it's a symbol of both the suffering and the death of Jesus, but it also points to the resurrection because it's an empty cross. So this cross that the Romans used as an instrument of evil, God changed it and used it to reveal the depth of his power and love for us. He communicated that to us in the cross. As Jesus suffered and died and he was abandoned on the cross, what was the Father doing? Well, the Father was suffering the abandonment of his Son as well. In the death of his Son, the Father is experiencing death itself as well. And the Father suffered the death of his Son as he loved the likes of you, me, and every other sinner who's ever lived through history. So the Father, too, knows suffering. His Son died naked on a cross, and he watched it. And if the Father allows the one that we call Savior and Lord to suffer, our suffering shouldn't surprise us either. Now, Paul spoke the next words I'm going to speak while he was in prison and probably with bruises on his body from the stones that other people threw at him. And they're powerful words for us. Philippians 4, 6 through 7. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for what he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. So he said, okay. Turn all your worries into prayers. Lift up your needs to God. Remember to thank him. And then what happens? Then that means this is a promise. I'm guaranteeing this for you. You will experience God's peace. And we can trust that God bends evil and suffering to his will. The fourth thing that Richard taught me is that since God ultimately wins, we win too. One way or another, our cries for healing are answered, either in the temporary victory of physical healing or in the forever victory of eternal life in Christ. I oftentimes think about when Jesus in John 11 heals Lazarus from the dead, brings him back from the dead after 4 days of death. I mean, he was really dead. The King James Version says, he stinketh. That's how dead he was, okay? I mean, it just meant he was really, really dead. And everybody was really reluctant because they didn't want to do what Jesus wanted to do here. But Jesus raised him up from the dead, and he told the people, now you release him and let him go. Help him. And they did. And here's Lazarus alive. And I always think, was Lazarus grateful to be alive again after he'd already experienced eternity? Or did he kind of scratch his head and say, Jesus, what are you doing? I know this is a great sign of the coming resurrection, but I was good. I was okay. And then in the very next chapter, there are a lot of people who want to kill Lazarus again. And Lazarus will again one day die. And then he will experience eternity again. Then he will ultimately win. Life is really difficult, but suffering and pain and evil never get the final word in Christ. That Richard knew that he was going to be spending eternity with God forever and ever and ever meant that he won as well. Henry Nouwen, a Christian, a Roman priest and a thoughtful man, he said, if God, who revealed life to us and whose only desire is to bring us life, loved us so much that he wanted to experience with us the total absurdity of death, then yes, then there must be hope. Then there must be something more than death. Then there must be a promise that is not fulfilled in our short existence in this world. Then leaving behind the ones that you love, the flowers and the trees, the mountains and the oceans, the beauty and the art and the music, and all the exuberant gifts of life cannot just be destructive and cruel end of all things. Then indeed, we have to wait for the third day. And resurrection people know what it means to honestly face the cross and believe in his ultimate victory, the powerful truth of that. The Apostle John was exiled in the island of Patmos, and he gives us this incredible glimpse of what we have to look forward to than that day of eternity that's on the way. Revelation 21, verses 3 through 4 says, I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, look, God's home is now among his people. He will live with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are done forever. That's what we have to look forward to. That's the reality of God's love prevailing in our lives. So let's remember that God walks with us. God works through us. God bends suffering and evil in our lives toward his will. And since God ultimately wins, that means we win too. And these are truths to rest in whenever we are compelled through suffering and circumstance to ask the question, why God? Why? Let's pray. Heavenly Father,